Hare Krishna.
You're a drummer? No, this boy. Let's see what happens. Okay. I think slowly people will drift in, but we don't have a lot of time. So even before they drift in, we're going to begin. Rajiv, you ready at 3 o'clock? Okay. So how many, including you ladies sitting in the bench, how many completed 32 rounds? Okay. How many completed more than 32 rounds? Wow. I don't know. Fantastic. I won't keep going. This is one of the nicest parts of, there's so many nice parts. First, I want to compliment the devotees that prepared something. The drama and the bhajans and Nityapriya, all that orchestration, the singing. I was upstairs watching from the balcony. Govinda Madhava song. Very, very nice. Very, very beautiful. Jai Jagannath's not here, but fantastic kirtan. Should have gone longer. We'll figure out how to do it longer next time. Whew. Very special. So thank you all for the part that you played, what to speak of the kitchen folks who aren't even here. So, did anybody chant 64 rounds? Wow. Would any of you who chanted 64 rounds like to volunteer to share what your experience was chanting 64 rounds by 2:20 in the afternoon? I don't see any hands up. Should I call on some of you? Krishna Swarup, you want to speak something? What was your experience and what helped you the most? Those kinds of things.
Hare Krishna Maharaj, I started earlier along with the Mangala Arati, so I could do 65 rounds.
Wow.
And the most inspiration is the Haridas Thakur. I used to chant, and whenever I feel sleepy, I used to go out and come back inside immediately and look at him. He's still sitting and chanting, so I used to continue. So I used to continue like that. Thank you, Maharaj, for your great inspiration.
Okay. Any other men chanted 64 or more? Yes, would you like to share?
Hare Krishna Maharaj. The first time I did 64 rounds in Gitanagri, this is the second time I'm making more than 64 rounds. Yesterday I was preparing myself to do more rounds. I don't know whether I can do 64 rounds or not, but I want to do more rounds. So before going to bed, I pray to Kishore Kishori that I need to have a good sleep so that I can prepare better for myself.
That's important. And, it's important to have good rest before chanting.
Yes. So luckily, yesterday I slept. I have a solid sleep. And I put my alarm for morning Mangalarati 3:45, and I wake up exactly 3:30. So I completed 76 rounds today.
Wow.
And there is my mother also came. So she also did 40 rounds. She came first time to Festival of Holy Name.
40 rounds? First time?
First time.
Wow. Very nice. Does she speak English?
What Maharaj?
She speaks English or no?
No, Maharaj.
No English?
No English. She felt very happy, so she didn't do more than 16 rounds. This is the first time
she did. We could ask her to share what her experience was. We won't even understand. At least some of us won't.
Yeah.
Hare Krishna. She looks happy.
Like Krishna Sarup Prabhu said, the divine presence of Haridas Thakur and Tulsi Maharani, so it gave a lot of inspiration today for to do further chanting. Thank you, Maharaj.
Thank you. Okay, from the ladies' side, any volunteers? Come on. Anyone, whether you chanted two rounds or 880 rounds, thank you.
Hare Krishna Maharaj, I got up early and I wasn't sure if I'll be able to chant or not. I was very distracted in the first set of 16 rounds. Then later after the class, it was very inspiring, that exercise you did, like finding out the incompleteness, the feelings of incompleteness.
That was your meditation?
Yes, Maharaj. And also,
what was the experience with that meditation?
With that experience, like I was kind of then trying to relate to yesterday's prayers of Lord Brahma, like humility, like I'm dependent, and I was praying to Lord Nityananda to I was praying to Lord Nityananda to actually allow me to chant from the heart. So in a mood of dependence, and then it felt like there is a lot of mercy and it's lifting up everyone in the room. So it was very nice after that. Thank you so much.
How many did you complete?
64.
Fantastic.
Thank you so much.
Shatarupa, I'm going to call on you. Go ahead. There's no volunteers. I'm going to have to call on people. You're next. I won't call Shamasaki. She's
The whole weekend was very, there are so many different messages that was helping me throughout the chanting, along with Haridas Thakur being present here, because we just heard Harinam Chintamani in our morning classes.
Yeah.
And it made an impact more when Haridas Thakur was here. And
He's so a powerful personality, huh?
And right next to Prabhupada, so it was very nice. And the messages that you spoke, Maharaj, this morning about the incompleteness, that is something I have been struggling with a long time.
Could you, same question, could you describe how that helped
experience.
You?
Experience.
What was the experience?
The experience was more like, the process is very simple, it's just chanting and hearing. Somehow I felt like my attention goes everywhere else except for this primary process. And like yesterday's Lord, like Kasturi Manjari Mate shared Lord Brahma's prayers as well as the bhajans that Badahari Prabhu did in Seattle. I did not hear, but I heard from Shirupa, like the experience, and we both discussed for the bhajans. And so the whole session, one by one, everything actually carried me throughout. So I'm very grateful.
Well, specifically, those prayers were selected by Badahari because they address the theme, or they speak the theme of humility. Did that touch you?
Yes.
How?
I've been facing some resistance for accepting myself in certain aspects of my person, and humility is the key principle that I need to accept. And during the chanting, that kept coming prominently to me. I have to practice humility, otherwise I cannot chant, and it's not going to work. That's the message I was actually getting. And because of the prayers and because of the presence here, it was easy to little bit let go and accept.
Fantastic. Yeah. Fantastic. Fits in exactly with the completeness thing also, that the sense of incompleteness as we take shelter elsewhere and we can't deal with who we really are because there's avoidance and non-acceptance and other acceptance, and we're stuck and keeps going around and around, and anything other than reality. And it's sense of incompleteness. And so humility breaks the barrier. Something that I said this morning, I didn't see you two here. You two team up with singing bhajan, so I have a request going into the future. Express something about the bhajan, which means, you know, get out of the comfort zone of being shy and speak something from your heart about what the message of the bhajan is. Right, Sri Rupa? Say yes, Maharaj. Thank you very much. Because, you know, the person who you take so much inspiration from his bhajan singing, just hear what he says. It's really easy. And then, but you know, be a parrot, you know, let it enter. And then from your own voice, touching your heart, you say, it'll be nice. You'll get more, and then you can give more too. Hare Krishna. Shriniti.
Hare Krishna, Maharaj.
You look distracted today.
Oh.
Were you? You were absorbed or distracted?
I was...
A little of both?
Yeah. actually, I was... My first round and my last round were the best. And then, like, in the middle, like, what really helped me was, in your morning class, you mentioned, like, staying close... and like close to Krishna and Tulsi Maharani and Prabhupada and Haridas Thakur, and that really helped me because in the past years I've always chanted like somewhere back there.
Yeah.
And this year I chanted more in the front and I was close to the deities, and it really helped me because I would look at their faces and then I'd be like I would actually connect better, and that really helped me. And what also helped me was, like, I would look at the Hare Krishna Maha Mantras on, like, the sides, and I would, like, as I would say it, I would read it, and I would, like, make sure that I was actually, like being absorbed in the words and, like, knowing their meaning and stuff.
Were there periods that you're hearing, not just your chanting, but your hearing was stronger?
Definitely. When I was, like, right near the deities, I noticed that I was more, like, I think it was like Krishna's mercy, but like I was more, like I've never felt that way before when I chanted, so it was definitely, I was hearing more.
Hearing more.
Yeah.
And praying more?
Yes.
Both?
Yeah.
Must have been nice.
Yeah.
How many rounds?
64.
64.
Yeah.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
We don't need a 64-round day. We'll just have a 32-round day, and everyone will chant 64 rounds. Or not everyone, some many. Very nice. Is anyone that was here for the first time that would like to share what their experience was? Yes.
Hare Krishna Maharaj. Although we had been wanting to come for Festival of Holy Name for last 2 years, but because of some or the other reasons we couldn't. So this is our first time, and I was feeling really enlivened, and the whole atmosphere was feeling very happy. Actually, all the deities, including Srila Prabhupada's deity, was very, very, happy to see all of us chanting together, and that was making me very happy.
Mm.
And
I felt just, that too. It was really nice.
It was so nice experience, Guru Maharaj, and all the like spiritual qualities we hear that I could feel in this atmosphere, like sense of security, fearlessness, confidence, and happiness. So that was a very special experience this time, Maharaj, and I want to continue to come for this Festival of Holy Name.
Couple of questions.
Yes.
Sounds like a lot of enthusiastic anticipation. Yes?
Yes, Guru Maharaj.
And that helped carry you, right?
Yes.
Were you, second question, were you able to participate in the activities prior to this morning? Like a lot of yesterday, or you were busy with preparing for the drama?
Yes, Guru Maharaj, and also my parents-in-law are here, so I was in morning, my preparations were okay. Completely in housekeeping and etc., so couldn't join.
So it wasn't so much what you heard, it was just your enthusiasm that carried you.
Through my preparations of the drama, Guru Maharaj, actually I went through the whole book Namacharya, that really touched my heart. And also the lectures in Gita Nagari, where you instructed to read more from a person who displays humility. So that whole series of things went in just near past. So it touched my heart really. And I want to continue to read that book.
You were chanting over here. Were you able to see Haridas Thakur?
Yeah, I chanted nearby Srila Haridas Thakur also for some time, and near Srila Prabhupada also some time. And
so with your meditation on Haridas Thakur, his presence here must have been a big...
Yes, Guru Maharaj, and with that also I want to just tell this, that I was feeling very... shameful is not a good word, but still I would like to say that, because I don't know if I could really convey the glories of Haridas Thakur properly or not. Even I just felt disqualified to see his deities today. I'm so sorry, Guru Maharaj. Really.
It's an offering of love. He accepted.
Thank you very much. Still, I felt happy that with the devotees, it will happen.
You offer with love, and he's not going to say, oh, go away. I don't like it. It's
sure.
Inadequate. I don't, you know.
Yes.
Offerings of love. Your sure. Devotion is very strong.
Thank you very much.
Anyone else first time would like to volunteer? Here. Oh, look at this. Over here. Then someone on the men's side, please. Yes.
Hare Krishna Maharaj. Please accept my humble obeisances, Aglaish to Srila Prabhupada. Maharaj, this whole atmosphere, it's like, I don't know exactly the words to describe, especially the bhajans, Shatrupa Mataji and Sri Rupa Mataji sang yesterday. And then Jai Jagannath Prabhu's kirtan, it was like...
There's more coming up, so stay tuned.
It was really something, Maharaj. I was like, even when I went home and I was like really meditating on that, especially these three, how they have taken that from your instructions and how you have passed Srila Prabhupada's mercy. It's so touching, Maharaj. So I was like deeply praying and... Sorry, Maharaj.
How many rounds did you chant?
64, Maharaj.
64? Wow. This is awesome. Would you like to share something, Mataji, in your native tongue? No. Okay. No force. Few things, simple. What's your native tongue?
Hare Krishna Maharaj.
What is your native tongue? Telugu? Yes? Say in Telugu. We're going to sing tomorrow morning some songs in Telugu. No problem.
నేను ఎప్పుడూ మాట్లాడలేదండి. నేను చాలా హ్యాపీగా ఫీల్ అవుతున్నాను. బాబు ద్వారా మాకు అన్నీ తెలిసినాయి. అప్పటి నుంచి లాస్ట్ ఇయర్ వచ్చినప్పుడు బాబు మొత్తం అంతా మాకు చెప్పాడు. తర్వాత ఎప్పుడు ఫోన్లో కూడా భగవద్గీత గురించి, భాగవతం క్లాస్ గురించి ఫోన్లో చెప్తూ ఉంటాడు. వాళ్ళ ఫాదరు నేను కూడా చాలా హ్యాపీగా ఫీల్ అవుతున్నాం. మా బాబు మాకు చెప్తున్నాడు అని సంతోషం ఎక్కువ. తర్వాత నెక్స్ట్ మా కుటుంబంలో అందరూ చేత కూడా చాంటింగ్ చేయించినాడు తను. అందరూ రోజు ఒక దండ రెండు దండలు చేస్తున్నారు. నేను మొన్నటి వరకు రోజు 5 దండలు చేసేదాన్ని. ఇప్పుడు మొన్న పిక్నిక్ వచ్చిన కాడించి 16 దండలు చేస్తున్నానండి. నా మనసుకి చాలా సంతోషంగా ఉంది ఇలా రావడం, మీ భక్తులందరినీ కలుసుకోవడం, మీతో మాట్లాడడం మరీ ముఖ్యమైన విషయం కదా. ఇంతకంటే ఎక్కువ చెప్పలేను.
I don't know what she said, but I bet it was nice.
Maharaj, I will just touch upon 1 or 2 points. Yeah, main thing Mataji was mentioning, she actually got this chanting through her son, and she's so happy for that, and he's making the so many of their family members to chant, and they're feeling so happy for it.
It's infectious. Okay.
Yeah, and daily she was chanting for 5 hours, and I think from last week onwards she's chanting for 16 hours.
Yay. Fantastic. Haribol. Anyone would like to volunteer on the men's side, please? I do know how to call on people. I have experience. Anyone can volunteer? Oh, come on. Okay. Thank you, Mukunda.
Hare Krishna. Maharaj, my experience was not good chanting, but I was just wanting to share that it made me appreciate how important it is to wake up early and chant and get proper sleep. I didn't do that last night, but so, I mean, I was here and I chanted most of my rounds here, and...
But it was a struggle?
It was a struggle, but it made me appreciate, you know, because of that negative, what you know, it's the positive, what can be when you prepare properly.
Any of the brahmacharis here distributed books last night at the concert? Anyone here? You did. It was Harinam. Harinam and book distribution? Some book distribution. But you know the party?
What?
Huh?
What was that last
What time did you get back last night? About midnight?
No. 6 o'clock or something like that.
6 in the evening?
Yeah.
No, the Harinam at the concert.
Yeah, we went in the afternoon.
You went in the afternoon?
Yeah.
So that party that went out went downtown to the Grateful Dead concert? I thought it's at night.
Yesterday?
Yeah. Oh, there's the hangout scene ahead of time.
Yeah, okay, there was okay.
I forgot what it's like.
It was really a powerful experience. It was like one of the most receptive kirtans I've been in, Harinams.
Receptive from their side?
From their side. Cause
what was the reception like?
Because there was a lot of like older people who have been like kind of hippies
for a while. Yeah.
So a lot of people knew about the Hare Krishnas from back in the day.
And
so
they were really happy.
Yeah.
You guys are still around. Right?
Yeah.
They were
it
saying?
Was almost like a reuniting with them, like from the past. But like, I wasn't there.
The baby boomers got happy with kirtan. Yeah?
It was really powerful.
Okay. How many of you all went on Harinam to the concert area? How many were there?
About 10, maybe.
10.
10 people.
Nice.
So it wasn't super big, but it was really nice.
That's okay. Then some brahmacharis went out again later to distribute books during the concert, or no? You don't know.
I remember, I think some devotees stayed back to distribute more books.
Okay.
Yeah.
Like Acharya Nishtha and a few others.
Yeah.
So what was your experience chanting here?
Here?
Yeah.
Well, actually, I went and stood up in front of Gaura Nittai, and I chanted like, I think it was like 24 rounds straight, standing right in the same spot right in front of Gaura Nittai. I was getting really absorbed in the forms of them dancing, because I've been going on Harinam, walking Harinam like the last week, like 3 times. So going out and dancing out on the streets, and then I was getting really absorbed in their forms, like so inspired.
That was a warm up for this, or this is a warm up for more Harinam or something.
Yeah, both. So that was probably.
What were you feeling in addition to feeling absorbed or being absorbed? What were you feeling? What was the experience? Happy?
Yeah.
Peaceful? Inspired?
Inspired, yeah, like excited. Like
excited.
My legs started like shaking. I wanted to like go out and do more Harinam.
More Harinam, look at that.
Not so much peaceful, more like a lot of energy.
Our temple brahmacharis love Harinam Sankirtan. They love Harinam Sankirtan. He's a lover.
It's true.
Fall in love with Harinam. Haribol. Anyone else would care to volunteer? Would you like to volunteer? Sundarananda, would you like to volunteer? Sure, okay.
Hare Krishna Maharaj. I chanted. I chanted only around 44 rounds today.
44? Yes. Okay.
One change from last time, when I made is instead of trying to be. I have the fruity tendency more. I always want goals. So I try to not aim at a number this time. So this time I just prayed to Kishore Kishori and Gaura Nittai that please make me chant whatever number of rounds is good for me. And then I chanted without forcing myself to go at a certain pace.
What was the experience like? There's goals and then this other whatever is good for me. What was the difference of experience? Mm. You understand the question?
Ah, yes, Maharaj. Okay. But this time it was more peaceful. So I'm not hurried or rushed to get to a number. This felt more relaxed and also like I was anticipating that Krishna is taking care. So I don't need to do much effort.
So you are in a receiving mode rather than a doing mode? Yes?
Yes, Maharaj, this time, yeah. Usually not the case, but this time only. Yeah.
So it felt peaceful?
Yes, Maharaj, it was very peaceful, yeah.
Are you standing right next to him, feeling peaceful and blissful and enlivened?
No, not so much, Maharaj. That's a lot. Thank you, Maharaj.
Okay, anyone from our TSI group would like to volunteer? I do know how to call on people, I'll remind you. Would you like to speak? Yes, thank you.
I actually completed 29, but I felt like the first about 10 were a good experience. I didn't get a great sleep, so I was falling asleep in the middle, which could have been improved, but I felt like the first 10 were good because they were very concentrated, and the last couple were okay. But I came to appreciate what focused chanting could do, because when you're very focused into chanting, it brings you to a different, I guess, a different level of focus into the holy name, which you don't come to appreciate much after you chant not very quality rounds for a long time. So once you get into quality rounds, then it's easier to focus on the holy name, even in kirtan.
Was there something about you or the circumstance or whatever that made the first 10 so positive?
Not necessarily. It was just that it was the first 10 and I kind of had a rush then.
Okay.
But I definitely felt like it's important to focus a lot more on chanting from this retreat because it could help you in kirtan a lot, especially yesterday in the Jai Jagannath Prabhu's kirtan. Everyone was very focused on the holy name.
Really focused.
And that made the environment very supercharged. So, I mean, it's very important to focus on the quality of your rounds, so that way, I guess your day just goes a lot better when you have very quality rounds.
Okay. Is there a plan for this evening's kirtan? Is it planned out? Is it, or just like, yes? Is there a plan? Yes? Could I hear the plan?
Sure.
I've just, you know, get us prepared and like warmed up and.
So basically four people will be singing starting at 6.
Okay.
First, should I say the names as well, Maharaj?
Okay.
Okay. Shruti will begin first, then Mukunda will take, and then Neil Madhav from there will take it.
Okay. Those that, I hope Jagannath is going to come and be, you know, even may he not have the microphone, but it says he's so electric when he's participating in kirtan. He loves it so much. Somehow get him to come. Somehow. Mukunda, you pull his chain and get him to come. Good. So, would you like to share? You got the microphone.
I mean, the one thing I felt, today was definitely more prayerful than other 32-round days. And I was actually just speaking with Jagadananda Prabhu, who had just called, and he was reminding me of Vrindavan Das Thakur's, he was reading some verses from the CC, and he was talking about how a long time ago I'd shared Vrindavan Das Thakur in the Maipur Youth Yatra, which is a long time ago.
Yeah.
But, and today, during this 32-round day, I wasn't necessarily focusing on Vrindavan Das Thakur, but I was thinking of the Maipur mood. All the different acharyas, especially Haridas Thakur was there, but it was just really helpful to be in that environment. And I felt more effortless today compared to other retreats, the 32-round day specifically. I kind of stuck around in that area in the back instead of being in the front where I used to be, and I think it somewhat helped to be in that area and to be able to focus.
It was helpful?
It was helpful, yeah, it was helpful.
Because you were with others of your peer group, or just because you weren't up in the front?
Just because I was not up in the front, and I was just able to focus more for some reason being in that area over there next to Haridas Thakur and Prabhupada.
Could you describe You shared that you were in more of a prayerful mood, and kind of the impetus started with this conversation with Jagatananda,
yeah,
right? So what was it like to be in a prayerful mood compared to the other times?
I think it was more of like that I need to pray, and the prayer was more of that, please just let me focus at least today, if not for the rest of my life, on the holy name. And I remember in the last few retreats, we did some tactics where we would put the bead back next to our heart and focus more on the listening part. So I was praying to the acharyas that just let me listen today and not get distracted with just whatever is going on in my life. Just focus on this moment.
It helped your mind to focus. It helped your hearing. What about your heart?
My heart was, I mean, I don't know much about the heart. It just...
Yes, you do.
I was a little nervous for some reason, but I think the heart felt more focused as well compared to other...
Part of the reason for asking specifically is Sachinandan Swami has this, one of his many different, you know, paradigms of how to effectively chant is the various levels of consciousness, and that, you know, the key to enter into the realm of Radha and Krishna is through the heart, and they have the key on the other side. So he calls it alignment, you know, that sits properly, you know, the sitting posture, the mind, the intelligence directing the mind, including in a prayerful mood, and then the heart. So it's like, and when there's an alignment, then Radha and Krishna open the door. One feels closer, like a personal connection.
Yeah, I mean, I felt, I guess, when you described that, I did feel more connected to the acharyas that I was meditating on. Instead of being a forced meditation, it felt that, it felt like a relationship to some extent.
Good, exactly. Okay. One or two others. Anyone up in the men's side? Okay, fine. If there's anyone that was here for the participating in an event like this for the first time, I'd like you to consider raising your hand.
Hare Krishna Maharaj. Yeah, this was my first time as well.
Oh. And,
I was like, when I was driving here, I was strategizing about how I'm going to do it. For somebody who does not finish 16 rounds, going for 32 is a challenge. So I was thinking, okay, half of it I'm going to do walking, half of it I'm going to do sitting and things like that.
You had it planned out.
Yeah. But actually, I'm thankful to Ankit also, because he got the word that helped me put together. And the word was effortless. I felt that, and I was not able to point out one thing, and that is what actually he did. So in that sense, it really was effortless for me today, and it was beautiful. It was not as difficult as I thought it could be, so that was very nice. And I was half the time concentrating on the deities here, and half the time I was trying to concentrate on Srila Prabhupada and Haridas Thakur. So it was beautiful, and thank you very much.
Did you feel carried by the presence of the devotees also?
Very much. I was just thinking that, okay, can I do the second 16 at home like this every day? And I said, no. It is all because of so many devotees around, a concentrated energy, which you know keeps motivating the moment you start thinking, okay, now I have to think about, I have to do this after chanting. But then I come back again. I could come back today. And that was all because of the other devotees who were chanting along. And so
no,
that was beautiful.
No. Not all because. That's a support.
Yeah, yeah.
But someone could be as drifty as the wind in such a situation. Even the support is there. Yeah. So it's not without that, you know, I'm a zero. Yeah. Which exactly what you said is you were invigorated.
Yeah.
And there was reciprocation.
Yeah, Maharaj, yeah. It was really nice to see everybody around just chanting. Usually when we come to the temple, we see some people working in the kitchen, others in the kirtan, and you know, everybody is so divided. Not that today they were not, they were doing their part of the service, but it was still very nice to see everybody.
Yeah, yeah. Very focused, it helps.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's without an elaboration, that's another type of sankirtan, although it's not musical, it's yeah. sankirtan.
Yeah.
What we just experienced. Okay. Anyone else? On the ladies' side, and this will be our last one because of time. So.
Hare Krishna, Maharaj.
Rajiv, get ready because you're next. Okay.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
I'm very grateful for this event. Year after year, although I couldn't make it yesterday, but I can see...
You missed a good one.
I can see how it establishes a samskara,
yeah.
Almost like a samskara, and yeah. I can see in my family year after year how we are preparing for the 32-round day and so on. Your morning class today was very helpful to me personally. The questions kind of gave me an inward look into myself, yeah. as to, you know, what is that, you know, I'm feeling incomplete in my life and where to really call out from. So that was very helpful to make that connection with myself while chanting. So I went through these almost like a roller coaster ride where I was feeling incomplete about this and I would call out, either my mind would propose things or it was the environment which was bringing up things, and I would start feeling...
Were there moments through all of that roller coaster, were there moments of feeling connected and in that connection feeling completeness?
Yes, there was. It would come up and then I would stay with it and it would subside with the calling out. And but I kept going through this roller coaster till the end. And in a way I could, the thing that I'm taking in is it's a journey in terms of...
Did you become prayerful at some point? Where
yes,
all that
I...
was like, whoa, roller coaster.
And yes, I did, and it subsided with the prayerful mood. It did subside, so that was part of my experience.
Okay. Well, once again, there are more people here now than when we began. Thank you all for, you know, like, it was really, really, really nice. Just observing, same as others have said, so many devotees just focused on chanting and some distraction, but focused on chanting. Really, really, really wonderful. And the efforts made by others to help us become focused in this prayerful and humble mood. A little introduction to what's about to happen. There's a group of devotees based in Houston and a few other places. Gopinath couldn't come because it's the 4th of July and they're doing their Rath Yatra in Washington, D.C. today with the Independence Day. So some couldn't be here, some came by invitation. The Sangha Initiative, parentheses TSI, is a group of devotees who are largely, not entirely, but largely from devotee families and younger generation devotees who want to strengthen their association and strengthen association of other young devotees in ISKCON all across the country. They're very active in promoting that sangha, and I really appreciate the work that they're doing, so I invited them to come and take a day. So that didn't work the way that we had initially planned it for different reasons. So from now on, it's their show, Sangha Initiative Group, and we'll start with Rajiv. Take it away, Rajiv. Srila Prabhupada ki jai. You want this or portable?
Hare Krishna, thank you very much. You all should be receiving one piece of paper and a pen. Try not to lose the pen because I only have one. There's 2 days of activities, one today and one tomorrow. So just the paper you can lose today, that's fine. But the pen is really important because I don't have another one for you tomorrow. As Maharaj had introduced, the TSI is a group of devotees from different parts of the country here in the US. And what I've tried to do is take the essence of what we do at a lot of our yearly retreats for TSI and condense it into a 1 hour exercise and 1 hour tomorrow as well. There's a lot of things to go through. And honestly, today is going to be going through a number of things which may be a little difficult just normally talking about it. And that actually is something that I'm interested in, just trying to get to the sense of, can we develop relationships with each other? Because my focus for the past year has been mostly in regards to fundamentals. So what are the basic fundamentals that we as devotees need to be able to do and to have in order to better improve our relationships with each other, improve our relationships with our respective Guru Maharajas and with the Supreme Personality of Godhead himself. These relationships are all very, very important. And so what we're going to be talking about today is actually something which you may feel uncomfortable about, and that's completely fine. I'm not going to be reading your mind. I'm just going to be talking about examples and ideas and thoughts that will help you guys, all of you all, go a little bit deeper into what you all know. And it kind of is the basic underpinning or the base to be able to have a lot more gratitude in everybody's lives today. So this is this basic first level. Today's the first level. And then tomorrow we'll be doing a lot more of idea generation because we'll be using a lot of the knowledge within this group of varied devotees from all over the place to go through one more exercise tomorrow. So, I would like to ask, in general, just as we're finishing passing out everything, that because of the nature of the activity and the kinds of things that you might be sharing with people next to each other, just try to be respectful and keep things confidential as they may seem appropriate, just because these are relatively intimate things that we'll be sharing with each other. So, does everybody have a piece of paper? And does everybody have a pen? Okay, I'm gonna give it maybe another 10 or 15 seconds, and I just wanna go ahead and Could I also have a runner with the microphone? Thank you. You're going to be doing a lot of running. All right. Are there any leftovers from the guy's side of the papers, the handouts? They need some more on the Mataji side. Okay. So, what I want to do is get started with an interactive discussion. And the idea behind both of these sessions is to be extremely interactive. There's no presentation. I'm not going to be doing any sort of amazing slideshow or anything behind the scenes. Really, a lot of the work is you guys talking with each other and you guys discussing with me and with each other. Okay? So, what I wanted to do was start a discussion right now. And I want to ask you guys, we're talking about this idea of vulnerability and shame. It's kind of a very scary topic to a lot of people. And I want to explore this specifically within the context of devotional service. Because there is a lot of times when we have this sense of shame come up. And I really want to explore just how this idea of shame and the associated idea of rather vulnerability can actually drive us and teach us more about our devotional service and guide us towards deeper relationships with each other and guide us towards higher levels of faith as well. So what I want to do is start out with a discussion on just asking you guys, when I say the word shame, what adjectives come to mind? Just raise your hand. If we get to you with a microphone, that's great. Just what adjectives come to mind when I say the word shame? Fear, okay. Guilt. Nervous. Anybody over here? Yeah. Lack of confidence. Avoidance. Embarrassment. So you see, none of those are positive adjectives. Literally zero. In fact, if you look at also just academic research behind shame, there are zero positively correlated outcomes of having shame. However, there's a big push, be it culturally, be it just as human beings, our tendency is to kind of force shame upon others. Because it's a very powerful motivator. To be shamed to do something, you're going to do it, whether you like it or not. But the idea of shame is there's no positive outcomes to it. So there's got to be some sort of alternative. There's got to be some other way to be able to get the same reaction, kind of being able to get people to do something without all these negative things that come to mind. Avoidance, embarrassment, nervousness, these adjectives that are not so great. So the specific definition of shame that I have, it's a negative, social, painful, and powerful affect. Literally the word shame comes from, I think it's Greek, and it comes from the word to cover. And so the idea is, this idea of shame is just, we're covering ourselves. It's not something that allows us to be completely open and engage in a relationship with our spiritual masters, with our fellow devotees, with Krishna himself. So, I want to make sure that this definition is very clear before we move on. This is very different from just feeling embarrassed, which is more fleeting. This is also very different than feeling humiliated, which is where somebody else did something and it's on them, where they made you feel somewhat shameful. And this is also different from regret, where you did something and you just feel bad. Oh, I did something bad. Shame, put very simply, is I am bad. Not I did something bad, but I am bad. And so this difference is very key because we all feel this in some way, in shape, or form. And the problem is, the vast majority of us push it under the rug. Put it and hide it away. Again, shame has zero positive correlations with anything out there. But The problem is if we keep hiding it under the rug, we can't feel the joy, the happiness as much as we need to and we can if we don't pay attention to this and keep sweeping it under the rug. So, again, this point of I am bad, it comes to the shame. Another definition we can also take a look at it is we feel like we deserve our shame. Like for some reason, just something happened and we deserve it. It just, we were bad. We are bad, we deserve it. It's not a sense of we deserve our humiliation. We don't feel like that. If someone makes fun of us, oh, I didn't deserve that. That person was doing something wrong. Like they were out of line. And it's not regret where, oh, I totally deserve to feel bad about it. I made a mistake and I'm going to rectify it and move forward. So these are all very different things. They're all similar in common parlance, in the way that we use it today, in common English. So I just want to make sure again, this definition is very clear as we continue. So I want to now open it up to another discussion and I want to ask a little bit more. So if you could finish this sentence. When I feel shame, I feel like blank. When I feel shame, I feel like blank. Over there. Hiding. Okay. My dad. Hiding under the rug. I feel like hiding under the rug. Okay. What else? When I feel shame, I feel like... Okay. Put it as more... A verb. Verbs are good. So what kind of verbs do you feel like doing? Avoiding, hiding? Attacking yourself, okay. Or attacking somebody else, okay. Say again? Scratching my nails. I'm not sure where that comes. Okay, can you explain? Oh, got it, okay. Trying to defend. Okay. Nervous to share. So these are really powerful things, what we feel, is when we have this sense of shame. We all have felt it. Everybody has felt it. But the problem is, a lot of times we're just afraid to talk about it. I haven't even asked a single question about what causes the shame at all. I'm just talking about when we experience it. And you can see just how powerful emotions come up. Just, we're afraid, we're hiding, we are scratching the floor, we are running away. These things aren't things that really will drive us to great devotion, great happiness, this chant and be happy. We can't do it if we're covering ourselves. So, what I want to do is just talk about what's the alternative? How can we move forward? And how do we pay attention to this and learn from this in order to better develop ourselves, our relationships? So, a lot of places who have this unconscious or purposeful sense of shaming others tend to result in disengagement, or they may blame each other, or there may be a lot of gossip, or there's just stagnation, there's not moving forward. Does that sound familiar to anybody? Have you ever been in any sort of group where that's the case? May or may not be the temple, may or be somewhere else. But in those cases, you can be sure that something along these lines is that there's a lot of senses of shame coming in. But the point is to pay attention to it and just recognize it. There is actually a research article that the University of Texas had done, and they were saying that in not talking about a traumatic experience can actually be more harmful than the actual experience itself. So in the sense of sweeping things under the rug or hiding it or covering ourselves can actually be worse than the actual event. So if something was embarrassing or caused some sort of shame, not talking about it is actually worse than just talking about it, hey, I felt it, I'm learning from it and moving forward. So, what I'm going to do is we're going to go through a few exercises where we start doing that stuff. And that's it's uncomfortable. I know that for very well. So, I want to talk about this next section, the second question on here. There is a phrase that I've either heard or was probably made up some years ago. Pure devotee syndrome. Those of you who have been devotees for a while may know of it. Those of you who haven't, let me quickly explain. So this specifically shows up in a lot of devotees who take up devotional service for the first time. And they're super gung-ho about it, which is great. But then they also take to attacking others, like, hey, why aren't you chanting 16 rounds even though you've never chanted a round in your life? Immediately, like right now. Why aren't you completely vegetarian right now, like this second, just like I am? Why aren't you making sure that you aren't following the four regulative principles like I am right now today? Without a sense of understanding where that person is, where they're going, what stage they're at, and understanding the real reasons behind following those. So, I want you to turn to the person next to you, talk a little bit about what you think or what instances you've seen this idea of pure devotee syndrome come into play, and how you might address it, or where do you think that might be coming from. So turn to your neighbor, talk about it for a minute or two. Sorry. Think about it for yourself for a minute, then turn to your neighbor and talk about it, and then we'll share with each other. So it's a think, pair, and then share. So think about it for yourselves, then pair with each other, and then share. What you think it is, where you think it comes from, just kind of what might be associated with that word. What comes to mind when you think of those? It's right on your paper. All right, I'll give you guys a couple minutes to think and then pair with someone, and we'll come back and we'll share as a big group. All right, if you haven't paired up, now's the time to pair up. Introduce yourselves if you don't know the person you're sitting next to. All right, another 30 seconds or so. All right. So, I'm glad that everybody's having a lot of discussions. What we're going to be doing is we're now going to take some volunteers from your different groups. Don't worry, people will settle down. All right, so I need a runner. If you can stand up at least. Thank you, Vivek. All right, any groups that would like to share? What was your discussion like? Right over here. You need to run, yeah. Make sure it has green, turn it on. Yep, there you go.
Okay. Basically, fault finding can be part of the pure devotee syndrome, and this can come from a sense of pride or possibly thinking that deep inside, thinking we could be doing something better, so we're actually overlooking our own faults and finding fault with others.
Sure. Mm-hmm. Okay, thank you. Any others? Other groups, what you guys talk about back there?
Srinath Prabhu had a really good point that when a devotee is not trained properly, he will think that he's the center of everything, and therefore he'll see people that are not revolving around him and ask them, why are you not doing this or why are you not doing that?
Sure, thank you.
The line is like, we tend to react if we are conditioned enough, so we will be reacting. So under guidance, proper guidance, we learn how to respond. So I can react to anything.
Sure.
But it takes a heck lot of efforts of other devotees to train us in, you know, responding to the issues.
Thank you. Anybody from this side of the room?
Hare Krishna Prabhu.
Hare Krishna.
People who have come into Krishna consciousness within 2-3 years, they develop a sort of feeling that they are pure devotees and they know everything. They must practice all the rules and regulations very perfectly without keeping mind on time, place and circumstance. And they develop themselves a superiority complex and make others also struggle themselves in following the instructions which this man proposed to preach. These people are really in pure devotee syndrome, and it is a problem for the others who is about to hear from them. And the others also try to practice in the same manner and they fall down, and sometimes they will get away from the Krishna consciousness because of the immature activities of the pure devotee syndrome people. That's what I think.
Sure, definitely. There are negative consequences to something like this. Thank you. Anybody on Madhuji's side over here? I want to have one or two groups, please.
I had something to say as well.
Oh, go ahead, Vivek.
I think pure devotee syndrome comes from narrow-mindedness, and Ankit and I were talking. It also comes from fanaticism. And it could be a phase that comes very early on in Krishna consciousness and then goes away really quickly.
So, but those are two very strong words, narrow-mindedness and fanaticism. Do you mind explaining what you guys meant behind both of those?
Well, I thought, narrow-mindedness could mean that you're very stuck in the mode of the perfect picture of Krishna consciousness and seeing that it may be easy in your point of view. While another person's situation might be harder in their world, and might be harder for them to, let's say, follow this one principle, or do 16 rounds, or do this Krishna conscious activity that may be hard on them in their situation. So being less fanatic or being less narrow-minded and seeing things in a more open view could allow you to see in their point of view how it's harder for them, and in time they can maybe achieve that feat.
So what I'm understanding then is you're considering both narrow-mindedness and fanaticism, really not considering the other person's situation?
Yes.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay.
Any of the Matajis or groups over there? I would like to have a lot of people sharing. This is a highly interactive exercise. Mataji, over here.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
So we thought about pure devotee syndrome means like just, holy name is everything, but we have so many conditioned tendencies from the childhood and everything. So it takes time to get purified and we have to, it's not that just by chanting everything will be all right and you'll go back to Krishna right away like that. And you should not force others also to be in that platform of chant all the time. And one more thing is expecting children to become pure devotees even though they are not even chanting one round. So, and that's pure devotee syndrome. One thing that we came up with is how to avoid this is like following the instructions seriously, step by step, and it will lead us to that stage. And yeah.
Okay.
Thank you.
Thank you. Another group, I saw someone back there.
I feel pure devotee syndrome comes from not having an honest evaluation of ourselves as to if I'm talking about I have pure devotee syndrome, it means that I am not honestly evaluating myself where I am. So I have a tendency of stepping up to be like somebody else. So that was one thing that I...
Sure. Thank you. So
setting up unrealistic goals.
Okay.
Like on Ekadashi, we won't eat at all. Like I will do 64 rounds from the first day.
Sure. That is something that I've definitely seen. All right. So kind of what I'm hearing from this discussion is definitely there's this idea of not paying attention to the other people that are out there. Like, what's the other person's situation? It's not being able to realize where your own situation is. It's fault finding or finding faults in someone else. It's this idea of forcing people to be at a certain level where they're just really not. Now, to be very clear, this is very different than helping someone to get to a difficult platform. That's very different. This is less, in that sense, there's a sense of teaching and understanding and mutual respect for each other as you work towards advancement. That's completely different. In this case, we're seeing it's a sense of compulsion. It's a sense of forcing or pushing. It's uncomfortable for at least one party. And that really, if you look back into the research and what that comes back to, that's drives right back into shame. Because, specifically, we tend to judge people in areas we're susceptible to shame. Point and very simple. We judge people where we're susceptible to shame. If I feel shameful about my steadiness in devotional service, or if I somehow don't feel so rock solid in there, that's a tendency that I may be able to judge someone else about it. To quote Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur, this is what he said, same idea. When faults in others misguide and delude you, have patience, introspect, find faults in yourself. Know that others cannot harm you unless you harm yourself. So Srila Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur takes the same idea. And it's this way to avoid this sense of forcing or compelling others or even just fault finding in others. That if there are certain ideas or things that you find that are just so terrible in someone else, take a minute, just pay attention to what's going on inside. Don't just sweep it under the rug. Don't just kind of hide it away, but pay attention to what's going on within you. Is that something like, hey, Maybe I really don't think that I can keep waking up at 2:45 in the morning every single day and then chant 64 rounds before I go to work and make sure that I never ever speak to anybody who doesn't chant 4 rounds a day. Maybe that isn't a reasonable expectation to have. But pay attention to what's going on inside. And pay attention, like, if something is bothering you, why is it bothering you? Really, that could be just take a sense, pay attention to where that's coming from, and learn from it. It's an opportunity for you to take stock of what's going on and then learn. Because from a sense of learning and understanding of what you need to work on as you yourself, if anything else goes on around you then, and you're completely secure in what's going on, it won't bother you. There could be senses where you want to help the other person, but it won't be coming from a sense of compulsion or forcing them or just trying to shame them or fault find with them. Again, two very different topics. Forcing them and helping them get to the next level. And this sense of difference is totally encapsulated within this sense of this feeling of shame. So, what I want to do is we need to move forward from this idea of shame and kind of think about this next step. So what can we do instead, and what's a good exercise that we can do to keep thinking and keep self-reflecting? And that's the idea of vulnerability. So in general, we cannot attach judgment to people asking help. That cannot be done. You cannot shame someone for trying to ask for help. That's shaming them. And that's getting that sense of, and that's going to result in those gossipy groups, those places where there's just zero, there's stagnation, there's no movement forward. Those ideas. We cannot attach judgment to help. We cannot also attach perfectionism to all this stuff. It's another form of shame that we can see. It's a sense of understanding where you are, accepting that, but also moving forward. So, because this perfectionism doesn't make sense, because where we try to be absolutely perfect and have zero sense of any sort of leniency anywhere, that's a place where we're susceptible to shame. This is slightly different than the idea of principles and rules and regulations, because if we have principles for ourselves, that's understandable, and that's something that we have kept for ourselves. But as we work with others and we have relationships with others, this idea needs to be that we need to make sure that we're not holding people to the exact same standards that we have immediately, or at least helping them move forward in a healthy way. Learning more about ourselves, where we find those pain points, those instances where you just can't stand that person or can't stand the way that that person does something. Learning that way, and then learning to understand and deal with that with ourselves, and then if you have a solid understanding of that, then you can actually help the person and you can help them move forward with that relationship with someone else. So what I want to do is actually start getting into something called vulnerability. So let's define vulnerability as a little bit different than shame. It's not weakness. Being vulnerable is not being weak. It's not about oversharing where you just vomit your life story in front of everybody the first time you meet them. It's not about that either. Vulnerability is about where you start to build gratitude. It's about where you start to build joy. It's where you build these relationships that are super strong. There's no ability to have any level of deep intimacy without this sense of vulnerability. And so what we're going to do for the next 20 minutes or so is go through exercises to start talking about this. So, I want you guys to go through the next set of questions that are there. Oh, sorry. One more exercise question with all of you guys. Vivek, where are you? You have the mic? All right. So I want to ask, based on my definitions, what else do you think of when I say the word vulnerability? What other words come to mind? Copy. Lack of knowledge. Okay. Weak. I just said it's not weakness. No, and that's fair. I'm helping reframe the discussion. I'm helping rechange the definitions of what everybody has in their mind. Vulnerability is not weakness. Susceptibility may be okay, but it's not weakness. Susceptibility means there is an ability for someone to go in. Weakness means there is, you can cause mortal damage. Slightly different in the sense and the subtleties of the word, but it's not just a sense, it's not weakness. What are the words? Yes, Krishna Shivatri. Being trustful of, sure. I completely agree with that definition. Lack of confidence in yourself. Okay. I wouldn't necessarily attach that to vulnerability. I would actually probably attach that more to shame. The reason I'm saying the difference between the two is because if you don't have confidence in yourself, you feel like you're bad. And that goes right back into, am I bad? That's probably something that stems from shame. Okay? Any others? One or two more? Yeah. Exploitable.
Like it's a gateway to exploitable.
So here, that is also another way that I think of the word weakness. And that's not what vulnerability really is.
Okay, I was reading in terms of technical things. Security vulnerability is exploited.
Sure. I mean, there is the potential to be exploited, but it's not the sense of being exploited at that sense. Because culturally, at least in the United States, we think of vulnerability as, hey, this person's a great person, we can walk right all over, they're not worth paying attention to, let's just kick them down and take care of them right there. They're weak. They're sharing something, they're weak. They're not worth our time. That's the cultural definition. What I'm trying to make sure we distinguish is between the actual definition of what vulnerability should be. Yes, one more. Innocence. Okay. Sure, yes, yeah, okay. I'm understanding that now. What I want to do now is vulnerability is, so here's a phrase I found. It's being naked on stage and hoping everybody's gonna applaud instead of laugh. It's because you're putting yourself out there right in front of everybody else, and you just know that everybody's gonna be happy about it. So what I want you to do is find a different partner, preferably somebody you don't know, and go through the next set of questions. There are 6 questions that I want you to ask each other and just get your responses. We're gonna do that for the next 5 or 10 minutes. Introduce yourselves, find someone you do not know, groups of 3 are fine.
going really well. But this is such a great topic. Great topic. I mean, like, when I incorporate it into the retreat somehow, it's like the number of people suffering with that syndrome. Everyone is to some extent. And it's just a matter of how much each person is suffering. Besides the pure devotees themselves. Everyone's suffering with this to some extent. Because it's all about like self-honesty, emotional integrity, and you know, most of us are not honest with ourselves. You know?
It takes a lot of work to get to that point.
It's like there's the devotees who seemingly seem like they're very advanced, and there's a devotee who everyone thinks like doesn't seem that advanced, but because in their heart they're very honest in their relationship with Krishna, that person might actually be more advanced.
The interesting thing is the devotees who don't think are advanced sometimes are the most advanced. Sometimes.
Because they're very, I notice some devotees like that, some of the sweetest devotees I've ever met. They don't seem very like, their actions don't seem like they're very like serious, but in heart they're so sweet, and they're like, I feel that they're very honest with themselves and with their relationship with Krishna. Like that shame doesn't cover them, you know? It's such a
I'm sorry, please keep discussing. This is leading into the next part of the
conversation. All right, we're gonna give it another 2 minutes. 2 minutes. Okay, everybody. I'm sorry to cut things short, but I want to make sure that we have time for the next section. All right, so I want to just debrief this. Let's have three groups just talk about their experiences. Three groups. Raise your hands, three groups. Any three groups? Right here.
So the first question was, before making a telephone call, do you ever rehearse what you say?
Yes.
Right. So I think there were two situations. Say if I was giving a casual phone call, probably I would not rehearse that.
Sure.
But if I was making a phone call to make a point to someone, or if I had an argument and I want to, you know, reemphasize my points, I definitely rehearse that. And why? I think I'm trying to get the point across to them, or I perceive that my point may not be taken from the other party, so I rehearse those situations, I think.
Okay, sure.
Okay.
I'm more looking for like just the general sense of how the exercise went, and just kind of what your reactions are from just that overall sense. Not necessarily the answers to those questions, okay. Which, I mean, thank you for sharing, but...
I think overall, from a discussion perspective, I think it made me introspect a few things, why, you know, some things that I'm doing casually, but never thought why I'm doing. Now it made me think why I'm doing things in certain ways, I think, from an introspection perspective, yeah. Mm-hmm.
Sure. Yeah. Thank you. Two more groups. Somebody over here, you guys are shy. Anybody over here? There's a lot more of the Matajis than there are men here right now. Somebody who hasn't shared before. Yeah, okay. Prem Thorangani Mataji.
So Prabhu, are we going through all these questions?
No, what I want to get is your sense of just how did the exercise go for you? What are your reactions from it?
Okay. Well,
I'm not looking for how did you answer them.
Yeah.
Because that's this level. I'm trying to go one level deeper.
Okay, so I think it was a nice, the series of questions were nice to just introspect and also like understand each other in a way, because most of the time we don't enter into deeper conversations. We are just like on, like, you know, share your realizations, yeah, Krishna is so great, but then I don't know what I am. So it's like, kind of helps. So that was the experience. I don't know, Mahati Gopi Mataji. It's the same thing.
Okay, one more group. Any group?
Typically, we are always thinking that you're the only one that feels a certain way, mm-hmm. and that you do certain things differently than how other people do it. But in my group, I realized that all of us had similarities, that we all felt the same way whenever we were answering some of these questions.
Sure, and that's kind of an important thing. As we keep understanding each other and realizing that there are similarities, it's good to get to that level of intimacy with each other, just in terms of relationships. As we're building relationships, if we can get to that level of depth, beyond just the, Hare Krishna, how are you, I'm doing well, that's great, and that's it, that isn't really a very deep relationship. It's the sense of starting to become vulnerable. These are actually quite intimate questions. This is not something I would just like go out on the street and just start yelling to people. These are questions that are like, they're deep, especially if you answer them honestly. Because raise your hands if you gave a canned answer like you already knew what you were going to say before you even really talked about it. I know at least one. No, you don't need to, don't feel embarrassed. Sure. Okay, I know that that's the case in some cases. That some people would just like, oh yeah, of course I'd be like Shukadeva Goswami. Of course. 1 year I'd know to die, of course I'd go like, Pariksit Maharaj. Of course I'd go to the side of the river and just sit there hearing Srimad Bhagavatam until I got bit by a snake bird. Duh. But that's probably not actually the case. What's the real answer that you would have given? Some people may be great. I'm not one of those people that I would be able to just sit down and listen to Srimad Bhagavatam for 6 days straight without eating, without doing anything. Okay, so I want to move into just how does this all link together in these last few minutes. So, how many of you guys can talk to me about the levels of faith that are explained in the Chaitanya Charitamrita? Who can kind of give me a quick summary of them? Hint, it starts with Adaushada. Anybody want to volunteer and just run through them? Okay, Shiruba, thank you. Yeah.
You want me to say all nine stages?
In English is fine.
Okay, I hope I remember that. Okay, it starts with a preliminary faith,
yep,
and then association with devotees, and then devotional, like practicing devotional service, and then the biggest stage, Anartha Nivritti, and then Nishta, the fixed, I think.
Steadiness, yeah.
Steadiness, then Ruchi, I think. Ruchi, taste comes next, and then Bhava Prema and something else in between, I think, right?
There's a Sakti as well, which is...
Ah, Sakti, there we go.
Okay, so it's a progression. For those of you who don't understand or have never heard this before, it's a progression from beginning levels of faith, of understanding just this preliminary understanding of, hey, this kind of sounds good, all the way through to actual feelings and rasa and these really high levels of stuff. So I want to talk to you about this last page. If you flip over your paper, there is two verses right there. Can I have someone from the guy's side read the first verse by Prahlad Maharaj, and then between you ladies, figure out somebody, one person to also read the last verse of Sikshashtakam, verse and translation. Someone from this side. Prahlad Maharaj's verse. It's on the paper. Did I just need you to read from there? Go ahead.
Nadanti kvachid utkanto vilajo nrityati kvachit kvachit tad bhavana yutas tanmayo nuchakaraha. Sometimes, upon seeing the Supreme Personality of Godhead, Prahlad Maharaj would loudly call in full anxiety. He sometimes lost his shyness in jubilation and began dancing in ecstasy. And sometimes, being fully absorbed in thoughts of Krishna, he felt oneness and imitated the pastimes of the Lord.
Just to note, because some people get caught up on it, in the purport, Srila Prabhupada explains that this is not a Mayavad philosophy, don't worry about it. All right, thank you. And then somebody from over here for the last verse of Sikshashtakam.
Ashlishya vapadaratam pinastumam adarshanan marmahatam karotuva yathatathava vidadatulam pato mat prananatastu saivanapara. Let Krishna tightly embrace this maidservant who has fallen at his lotus feet, or let him trample me or break my heart by never being visible to me. He is, what is that word? A debauchee, after all, and can do whatever he likes, but still he alone and no one else is the worshipable Lord of my heart.
Thank you. So, what I want to do is kind of call to attention the sense of these verses. Do you kind of notice how both of these, I mean, if you look at the word-by-word translation, which you don't have, I know, but in that verse by Prahlad Maharaj, there's a word, there it is, vilajo, right? That second line, first word. In the word-for-word translation, Srila Prabhupada translate that as without shame. So Prahlad Maharaj, without shame, would go about and imitate the pastimes of the Lord. He would call out in anxiety. These things are actually quite abnormal for just a normal person that we see from a day-to-day perspective to do. Sharing these kinds of things is actually quite vulnerable in terms of showing where Prahlad Maharaj's senses lay, just out there, completely out there. And knowing Prahlad Maharaj's story, we know fully well that just he had needed to have complete and unshakable faith with the Supreme Lord in order to be protected with him, by him. And it's not like it was very easy for Prahlad Maharaj, but there was just a lot of sense of just needing to be vulnerable. This vulnerability was the setting, the stage for this intimacy. It's not that Prahlad Maharaj would be able to just automatically receive these gifts from the Supreme Lord. There needs to be some sort of relationship already there. Furthermore, if you look at Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's Sikshashtakam, this last verse, that also is extremely vulnerable. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu expresses just how vulnerable he is with the Supreme Personality of Godhead. He can break me. That's not something that I want anybody to do with me. Like, just break me. He can do with me whatever he wants. That's extremely vulnerable. But we know fully well of Chaitanya Mahaprabhu's relationship with himself, I guess, the Supreme Lord, that it's of extreme devotion. So, if you take a look at Bhaktivinoda Thakur's Bhajana Rahasya, this book, it starts explaining how each of the verses of Sikshashtakam tie back to each of the levels of faith. And being the last verse of the Sikshashtakam, we know that through the Bhajana Rahasya that this verse actually ties right back into this last level of faith, prema. Specifically, awakening of love, as one of the definitions is given in the Chaitanya Charitamrita. So it's only at this stage can we see that this level of vulnerability is required to be able to get to this level of, to have this level of faith, to have this relationship, this depth of relationship with the Supreme Lord. So what I want you guys to do for the last minute, and just kind of to summarize and close up the discussion, is write for a full minute whatever comes to mind, don't stop, about these two verses in our discussion and whatever's come up today. You have that whole second half of that paper to do so. One full minute. Whatever comes to mind. Even if you have to write blah, blah, blah while you're thinking. Just keep writing. If you're feeling stuck, just start writing something. Hello, my name is Rajiv, I'm sitting in class. And then eventually you'll start thinking of something to start writing. Another 25 seconds or so. All right, so wherever you got to is perfectly fine. Whatever sentence, just finish up your sentence, whatever thought you're on. And let's close up the discussion just for today, because tomorrow we'll build off what we talked about today, and we'll be working on something else tomorrow. So, how'd it go today? What you write about? Anything interesting that kind of came out of today's discussions? Stuff like that. Just raise your hand, feel free to share. Even if you have a word or something, that's great. Anything you want to share about today? Or if you have any questions, that's fine too.
Yeah. I have a question and then I'll pass on. In the very beginning you said, what is shame? And that translates to, I am bad. I did not actually make that connection, and I still don't. If you can explain it later also, it's fine.
Sure. So the idea of this sense of shame, it's this idea that we, it's equivalent, it's just a definition. It's a sense, this idea of shame and constantly feeling it is the idea that we are bad, is that feeling. It's just one way to explain what that feeling is like. That's what I'm trying to explain.
Okay. Thank you.
By reading the both the verses together, I was able to make connection the topic you talk about, shame and vulnerability. Because Prahlad Maharaj is feeling very free here, you know, like he was able to give up his shyness and he's feeling jubilant, and I felt he's feeling freedom because of the second you know, Sikshaktam 8 verse, that he is fully feeling dependent, and in that dependency he is feeling freedom. So that's what I felt. That's the
greatest
we can gain.
Thank you. Maybe two more people just because of time.
To vulnerability.
So this idea, it's one is more of just a definition type thing, and understanding that we need to keep paying attention to ourselves. So this idea of paying attention to ourselves lead to the sense of vulnerability, because if we keep pushing something under the rug, we keep thinking we don't need to pay attention to it at all, that something isn't worth paying attention to, that it isn't a sense that we need to share it. Without sharing the sense of shame, we're not going to learn from it, we're not going to be able to grow from it. Being able to do so requires vulnerability.
So the you asked me to summarize the thoughts.
Sure,
at
yeah.
The end of the class. So vulnerability, the way I understood vulnerability based on the discussion is having an open heart and being honest with both oneself and with our spiritual master.
Sure.
And being naked in our thoughts, in our feelings, this is what basically I understood. Is that in line with what you were saying?
This isn't a discussion for everybody to learn.
Okay.
So that sounds fine with me. All right, one more person, just so we can set up for the yajna that's happening afterwards.
Thank you, Raji Prabhu. I really felt very happy, but basically what I think is, you know, opening our hearts, especially when, you know, Chaitanya Mahaprabhu and his Sankirtan party goes to the street, they doesn't care who is looking at me. They are basically just dancing, you know, just, people say, are you crazy dancing in the street, correct? So in that way, we should be opening our hearts for service of Krishna, doesn't matter, whatever you are. So that's what I totally got it from you. You know, doesn't matter whether, you know, pure devotee syndrome, of course, it's always there, but it will open your heart, saying what you are, and get out of all those pure devotee syndrome, and do a real service to Krishna in a honest way.
Sure.
Okay?
And the real point of that is, it takes a lot of work to get there, to get to the point where you can just walk out in the street and just start dancing. I mean, it may not be actually walking out in the street and dancing, but whatever that may be in your life. All right. Thank you all very, very much for participating in today's discussion. If you can hand back the pens or keep them for tomorrow, we'll be going through the next step of this as we go even further into this discussion. All right. As we need to set up, I think we need to move out of this area. So if everybody can clear this area so we can set up for the yajna. Other mics. Sing it right now is fine. During the yajna, they'll be different. Yeah. We'll set that up later.
Hare Krishna. Hare Krishna.
It's not tight?
Yeah, loosen it, loosen it. I want to push this up.
You can say here, but you want to say here.
I think it's closer.
You want to make it tight?
Oh, no. Oh,
this one?
Okay. Okay, loose. Okay, okay, that's good. Hare Krishna. Okay. I want to make it so people can get sit, you know.
What?
I want to put it close so people can sit here. Hare Krishna. Can you tie this up here?
Namo Vishnupadaya Krishna Prasaya Bhutale Srimate Bhaktivedanta Swami Tinamine Nama. Namaste Saraswati Deve Gauravani Pracharine Nirvishesha Sunyavade Pasketa desatarine Jaya Sri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Sri Advaita Gadada Sri Vasari Gaura Bhakta Vrinda Jaya Sri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Sri Advaita Gadada Sri Vasari Gaura Bhakta Vrinda Jaya. Rama Raghava, Rama Raghava, Rama Raghava Rakshama, Krishna Keshava, Krishna Keshava, Krishna Keshava Pahi Ma. So the title of this Bhajanam Kirtan is Krishna's Protection. It also goes to the chanting of the holy name. It goes down to depth, Krishna's protection. Krishna, 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 hey, Krishna. Krishna, 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 hey. Krishna, 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 Rakshama. Krishna, 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 Pahi Ma. Rama Raghava, Rama Raghava, Rama Raghava, Rakshama. Krishna Keshava, Krishna Keshava, Krishna Keshava Pahima. Krishna Keshava, Krishna Keshava, Krishna Keshava Pahima. Krishna, 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 hey. Krishna, 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 hey. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, 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 Hare Hare, Hare Ram, Hare Ram, 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 Hare Hare, Hare Krishna. Thank you. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Ram, Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare, Hare Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare, Hare Krishna. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare, Hare Krishna. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Ram, Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare Hare, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Ram, Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare Hare, Hare Krishna. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Ram, Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Ram, Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna,
Yeah.
Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare, Hare. Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare, Hare Krishna. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare, Hare Krishna, Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare, Hare Krishna. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare, Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama.